Hello, family. It is Wednesday and is Refueling Your Faith, and it is the first day as we walk through the Bible for the year. And can I tell you that I am super excited about this year-long series? I have just been studying and just excited about what I will learn as I study, what more I will learn, and what you will learn as we walk through this together. So today we're going to be walking through the very first book of the Old Testament. Old Testament, it's important to understand the Old Testament means really the old covenant, the old way that we used to relate or have a relationship with God, those who are with Jesus Christ, or even just whether you know Jesus Christ or not, we are in the new covenant. We are in the new way that we relate to God, and that is through Jesus Christ. But we're going to learn about the old covenant, the old way, the Old Testament. And so the very first book is Genesis, and Genesis means the beginning. And we believe, not exactly sure who wrote it, but we believe it was Moses that wrote it. And in this book, we find out about how we all came about, how this whole world came about. We find out in the book of Genesis. The first 11 chapters help us to understand that. So in the first chapter, we find out that God created the heavens and the earth. We don't believe in evolution. We don't believe that there was a big bang and things were created through different molecules or whatever that theory is. We believe that God created the heavens and the earth, that on the first day he created the earth and heaven. And then throughout the rest of the days, he created the birds. He created humankind. He created the vegetation. He created all of those things. And as we read the chapter one, we find that out. And then we get a closer look at his creation of mankind when we look at chapter two. But in chapter three, we find Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, and they did not follow the instruction of God. They ate from the tree of good and evil, and therefore they sin entered the world. Sin entered because Adam and Eve did not follow the instructions God gave them. And because of that, as we read the curses in chapter three, then we're not able to experience the life that God wanted for us in the beginning. In the beginning, there was not going to be death. There wasn't going to be sickness. There wasn't going to be any of those things. But because of sin, now those things have entered and into the world. And as we continue to read throughout those chapters, we find out that God becomes so angry with the people because they are so disobedient, so wicked, that he then decided to destroy the world with the flood. And therefore, we get the book. We meet Noah, and Noah builds an ark, and he and his family, which was about eight people, his three sons and their wives, and he and his wife jumped on this boat along with two of every kind of animal, male and female, and the world was destroyed through a flood. And so that's where we get that there's an argument in the world, there's an argument that says that the world is millions of years old, or is it thousands of years old? Those who believe in the count of Noah, the story of Noah, that believe that it actually happened, many believe that then the world is only thousands of years old, because God could create fossils and he created all those things when the world was destroyed by a flood. And so those fossils were created because animals died and plants died and those things. But then there's another side that maybe do not believe in Noah or believe that the flood actually happened, and they believe that the world is millions of years old. Just a basic overview. Of course, it's a lot more intricate, but I'm really impressed by an organization called Answers in Genesis, and you can find out more information about that. They actually have a museum in Kentucky called the Creation Museum, which talks about creation and how it could come about that all of these things could happen, that it wasn't created through a big bang, but God actually created it. And it has scientific evidence to support that the Bible is true. And so I'll take a look at the Creation Museum. I'll put that in my comments, as well as the Ark Encounter that helps you to understand Noah and how he was able to keep all those animals in an ark and all the science that allowed him to do all of that. So science actually backs up the Bible. We want to say that the Bible is not scientific, but it really is. And we have accomplished scientists that are proving that. But anyways, Noah, then the flood recedes, and then Noah is able to recreate and repopulate the earth, and then they decided that they were going to build a tower to the heavens. And so God scattered the people, scattered their language, which allows us then to understand how the whole world was populated. Well, that's because of the Tower of Babel. But we then begin to look at 12 chapters 12 through 50 about the people of Israel, how God is going to save the world from sin. Then we look at Abraham, we look at Isaac, we look at Jacob and his 12 sons, and we end in Egypt through Joseph. And you all know the story of Joseph. If you do not, then you can read that for yourself, because I do not have time. But Egypt, Joseph, because of the deceit of his brothers, is now in Egypt, and he's in control of all Pharaoh's affairs because of God blessing his life. And now the Israel, Jacob, and his 12 sons move to Egypt out of Canaan, the land that God promised them. And that's where we end in Genesis. And so next week we'll begin in Exodus to find out how they return to Canaan, the promised land, what God promised Abraham, that he would populate the earth and that they would have the land that he was living in, which was Canaan. But now they're in Egypt at the end of Genesis. And so in Exodus, we'll find out how they return to Canaan. But in terms of highlighting some scripture within the book of Genesis, the beginning, how we all began, I want to look at Genesis 4 and 7. And Genesis 4 and 7 is talking about the children Adam and Eve had, Cain and Abel. And Cain was a tiller of the ground, and Abel was a keeper of flock. And they presented an offering to God, and God was not pleased with Cain's because he did not give him the first of his fruit, but he was pleased with Abel because he gave the first of the flock to him. And so Cain became angry, and he became angry. And so that's where we find our verse for today. And it says, chapter 4 and 7 says, "If you do well, will not your countenance be lifted up? And if you do not do well, sin is crouching at your door, and its desire is for you, but you must master it." And that is a challenge that we all had. Cain is deciding how he's going to manage his anger, and God is telling him, hey, sin is crouching at your door. And if you do not manage that, then there's going to be a problem. You must master the sin that is crouching at your door. And that's what all of mankind is trying to do, master sin in our lives. We have to realize that there is sin because of what Adam and Eve did in the Garden of Eden. All of us struggle with sin. And there is a curse that is on this earth simply because of their sin, which is in chapter 3. And so because of that sin, then we have to be able to try to master the sin, the things that we should not do, as well as the things that we should do and choose not to do. That's sin in our lives, and God is not pleased with that, and that sin separates us from God, the creator of all of earth and creator of us. And so therefore, if we're separated from God, we cannot participate in the purposes that he has for us, and therefore we have guilt and we have shame, just as Adam and Eve felt shame because they were naked and they covered themselves when they did not feel that shame initially. And so when we are not mastering sin in our lives, and we do not have the right relationship with God, then we will live that same way too, in shame and in separation from God, not understanding our purpose. And so we have to learn to master it. And we thank God. I thank God, as we learn in the New Testament, is that Jesus Christ comes to save us from the sin, to help us master sin. In fact, he mastered sin. And so we can then live according to that mastering. He gives us the Holy Spirit to do that. And so I pray that you will stick with me as I walk through the Bible. I pray that this Genesis has given this study on Genesis, or this talk on Genesis, has helped you understand the book of Genesis just a little more. I know there's not a lot of time, but I don't want to overwhelm you with information, but just whet your appetite that you would want to know more. And so I pray that you would begin to recognize and be thankful for the fact that God has sent Jesus Christ to help us to master sin, that we do not have to be like Cain. Cain eventually ended up killing Abel, but we do not have to succumb to sin. We can be victorious over sin because of the blood of Jesus Christ and because he died on the cross for our sins. So come with me next week as we walk through Exodus to learn how we got back to Canaan, even though we were living in Egypt because of the famine there. Read Genesis, because I cannot go into all of detail of what that is, but you can read it for yourself. And I'll be praying for you. You pray for me. I'll see you next week. God bless.